Ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, I would like to begin by thanking the Macedonian Society of Great Britain and the Hellenic Center for this invitation, and you all for your presence here today. I would also like to stress that this project is the result of the work of a team of specialists and that each person's contribution was essential in carrying out this collective enterprise. The Kasta Tumulus. Hello? The Kasta Tumulus is found on the edge of the ancient necropolis of Amphipolis, next to Hill 133, which was inhabited between the prehistoric era and the archaic period. It contains a small section of the ancient necropolis of this settlement. The tumulus was created using earth transported from other parts of the region in the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ. The tumulus is 33 meters high and is on the edge of the ancient site of Amphipolis, next to the navigable river Strymon. Amphipolis was founded in 436 BC and was an important city in ancient Greece in the classical, Hellenistic, and Roman periods. The excavations carried out from 1960 to 1985 revealed an ancient gymnasium, houses, temples, and a wall surrounding the city of Amphipolis, which were dated back in the classical period. The Kasta Tumulus had been excavated a number of times prior to the current project, uncovering the prehistoric and archaic necropolis, but the peribolos, or surrounding wall, at the foot of the tumulus remained undiscovered, lying 50 meters below the surface of a farmer's truck that encircled the tumulus. Funding was needed to begin research, and it was thanks to a small funding allocation from the prefecture of Ceres that the excavations were able to begin. Various field surveys around the tumulus led to the discovery of part of the surrounding wall. The first discovery unlocked further and more substantial funding from the Ministry of Culture, which enabled the excavation work to continue until 2014. You see the perivolus. The latest excavations from 2012 to 2014 have revealed a continuous surrounding wall, a peribolus, 497 meters long, 3 meters high, with a diameter of 158.4 meters, covered in expertly cut and fitted marble cladding, brought from the marble quarries on the island of Thasos and dated to the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ. The wall was an uninterrupted intact section of 100 meters. The peribolus, you can see. Yeah. The Institute of Topography of the University of Athens, Professor Paganis, produced the laser scanner images that follow. I will also share various drawings suggesting the method used for the transportation of the marble from, by boat from Thasos, the construction of the Peribolos and the Lion in the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ, and lastly the recovery of a large part of the marble and the Lion in the Roman period. All the restoration work done on the Tumulus has been carried out in collaboration with architect Michalis Lefantzis. You see here this is the Peribolos. And the Tumulus with the laser scanner images. You can see this. The Lion of Amphipolis, which is now found on the right bank of the stream or river, used to crown the top of the Tumulus. It is a statue of marble from Thasos, standing 5.30 meters tall. It was found in 1915 in the ancient stream or river bed, together with a number of marble slabs that would have covered the Peribolos, the surrounding wall. This is the Lion and the marble slabs. It should be noted that the fragment of the lion's mane was found in August 2014 near the entrance of the tomb. This finding helped to confirm the theory that had put forward in 2012. Research has shown that the lion's current plinth was made of slabs taken from the Peribolos in the Roman period to build dams on the Strymon River. This material was recovered by the Greek army in 1912 when the modern bridge over the Strymon was built. In 1917, the marble slabs were piled up next to the bridge. They were to subject of studies by Orlando Perdriget in 1936, Roger Bronir, who had used the marble to build the plinth for the lion without being aware of this origin and purpose. The origin of the marble slabs thus remained unknown. Stefan Miller, the director of the American School, found part of this material in Lithotopos in 1971, near the barrage of Lake Kerkini, and moved it in Amphipolis to Amphipolis next to the Lion. You can see the material. He dated the material to the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ without having located the monument that the material came from. It was not until the excavation of the Peribolos in 2012 that the origin of the slabs was discovered, and it was possible to link them to this monument. In November 2014, a fall in the water level of Lake Kerkini uncovered further marble slabs from the Peribolos, transported there and used for the barrage that was built on the lake in 1936. These slabs were taken to the Museum of Amphipolis. There are no doubt more slabs still to be found in the lake. The next stage in the excavation of the wall revealed the south-facing entrance to a monumental tomb opposite the city of Amphipolis. This is the slabs from Kerkini. And here, you can see the lion at the top. Seventeen steps led from the wall down into the tomb. You can see. The tomb contains four separate spaces, which we will refer to as chambers, separated by partition walls. The first two chambers were protected by two 4-meter walls made out of local stone. This sealed the access to the chambers and protected their sculptures. They had no doors. The partition walls, however, have a 1.67 meters opening in them. The four chambers had been filled to the ceiling with a mixture of sand and earth. They were excavated two by two to avoid destabilizing the structure of the monument. The floor in the first chamber, which is 6 meters long and 4.5 meters wide, and is connecting to the stairs, is covered by a mosaic of grey, black, red, and yellow small pebbles set out to create a geometric decoration of rectangles and lozenges. The side walls are covered in marble imitation stucco. This is the mosaic. And other examples comparable from the region. Two 1.45 meters acephalous sphinxes face each other, decorating the pediment. Their chests have been mutilated. This pediment, which reaches its highest point at 2 meters in its median section, is made up of the semicircle at the end of the barrel vault. It crosses the monumental entrance opening into the second chamber. The sphinxes are made of marble from Thasos. Their wings and heads were both separate pieces added on. The sphinxes. One of the heads, which is remarkably well preserved, except for a chip on its nose and exquisitely sculpted, had been intentionally moved into the fourth chamber and placed under its stucco stone ceiling to protect it. It still shows traces of red pigment in its hair. Pieces of the wings were found in the burial chambers. They are currently being examined in the laboratory, and it has already been possible to reassemble some of these pieces. These examples. The wings. And the examples comparable from other sculptures. Under the sphinxes, once the protection wall made a local stone was taken down, the original facade was revealed, decorated by pillars on either side of the opening and by an epistyle with an Ionic chymatium. The tops of the pillars are elegantly decorated with a red and blue Ionic chymatium. This is the head of sphinxes and other comparable examples from Vergina. And this is the Ionic chymatium. The second chamber is 6 meters long and 4.5 meters wide. Its walls, as those of the third and fourth chambers, are covered in marble from Thasos. Its design is identical to the design of the marble slabs used for the wall outside. A mosaic of small pieces of marble on a red background covers the floors on this chamber, the second in the tomb. Six meters from the partition wall, a second wall was uncovered. It has a marble cornice decorated with rosettes of 8 petals, held up by 2 caryatids, which were hidden, except for their head, by the second local stone wall, 4 meters high, which was the second protection wall. You can see here the protection wall and the caryatids. These 2 caryatids were fully revealed when the protection wall was taken down, are 3 meters tall, including their base. Their base measures 1 meter, and the caryatids 3 meters. Both the bases and the caryatids are made of marble from Thasos. These bases belong to the same craftsmanship as the cladding on the Peribolus and the chamber walls. The caryatids. details. The face of the first carotid is intact. The face of the second has been mutilated by the fall of a piece of the cornice, which fell on the earth filling, possibly as a result of an earthquake. The hair of the carotids, which falls to their shoulders, is curled and tied back with a ribbon. Their hair is red. And the other? They have red earrings in their ears, and they are wearing a sleeved imation hanging loosely around their bodies, which can be seen through the fine material. The upper hand holds up the blue-gray imation, which falls to the high red and yellow sandals. The toes are perfect cut. The left and the right arm are raised, as there is no trace below the epistyle to suggest that the hands were holding it up. We are led to understand the carotid gesture as a symbolic prohibition to enter the tomb. The two figures give the impression that they are moving forward and they are about to come to life. We have comparable examples, some examples from other, from Bulgari, Svetsari, Niovida Tsiaramondi, Avatican, Louvre, in Paris, Columna Kelata, in British Museum. The Museum of Thasos. A third chamber of 3 times 4.5 meters opens out behind the carotids. Its floor is entirely covered by a large mosaic of finely cut stones. This mosaic represents the abduction of Persephone by Hades. Hermes, the psychobomb god, responsible for guiding souls to the underworld, wearing his petasos, chlamys, caduceus, and his winged sandals, drives a chariot, a bika, drawn by 2 white horses. One of them has black eyes, while the other has 1 light blue eye and 1 black eye. The black eyes are stones of the blue eyes, and the blue eye is made out of glass paste. The driver is Hades, depicted with a beard, with red hair and a laurel crown on his head. He is wearing a red imation. Persephone, who has golden blonde hair with red tints, is wearing a fine imation held up under her breast by a red belt. She is wearing a necklace and a bracelet on her right wrist. She is lifting her left arm in a sign of despair. The composition is outworthy because of the harmony of its colors and its naturalism. The author of the painting on which this mosaic is based was a great artist of the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ. The theme of the abduction of Persephone can also be seen in Vergina. In In the top known as Persephone's tomb, executed using fresco painting, and in the so-called tomb of Eurydice, mother of Philip II. We also find an abduction, that of Helen, in the house of Pella. You can see the example. Dated back to the first quarter of the 4th century before Christ, this last comparison helps us to date the stone mosaic at the Kasta Tumulus, and therefore the tomb, to the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ. It is the only depiction of this team using the stone mosaic technique. Amphipolis Epella. Also. And in Pella, the house of Dionysus. The scene created using white, black, red and yellow small pebbles, according to antique tetrachromacy, stands out from a black background and is framed by meanders. The center was been damaged by a large part of the stones had been found on site and the restoration work has already begun. The mosaic. When we entered the room, part of the stone ceiling, which has a blue, red, and yellow decoration of rosettes, could still be seen to the side between the chamber's two side walls. This is a horizontal ceiling 2 meters below the vault. The wall coping blocks under the ceiling fell on the earth filling of the chamber. They present traces of red, yellow, blue, and black pigments and images that are unfortunately damaged and insufficiently visible. Here, masculine and feminine figures, some of which are winged and vases which appear to be Idria. We will have a better idea of what these images represent and how they are to be interpreted once the cleaning and restoration work is completed. The Idria, the Taurus, Sphinxes. The wall of the end of the chamber opens into the fourth and the largest chamber, which is 6 meters long and 4.5 meters wide, and is the funeral chamber proper. This is therefore another partition wall, but it has a marble door with a marble threshold and door frame. Both of the door leaves were found lying on the floor, where they had fallen into the fourth chamber. As the previous ones, this fourth chamber is clad in marble. It has a stone floor covered with white stucco. A vaulted coffin was found under the floor. And it is covered in slabs of stuccoed local stone. The skeleton lay at the bottom of a wooden coffin 9 meters under the ceiling. The bones were found inside and around the coffin, of which only a few decorative elements and a few bronze nails remained. They were removed in block with a surrounded earth for careful excavation in the laboratory. It has, however, already become apparent that the skeleton had been disturbed by pillaging that only left part of the skeleton. No offering has been found. The ancient pillagers had taken it all away. As regards the anthropological material, it has yet to be examined by specialists. All these elements. And examples, some examples, comparative. The vases. The ceramics, vases. The funerary complex of the Kasta Tumulus therefore points to this having been a considerable undertaking, drawing on the largest amount of marble ever used in ancient Macedonia for its construction. The extraordinary cost of such a construction makes it improbable that it could have been used for the burial of a private individual. The tumulus, which is 33 meters high, with a 15-30 meter lion, including its base on top, a peribolus of 4790 meters in circumference, a monumental tomb decorated with sphinxes, caryatids, and a small pebble mosaic representing the abduction of Persephone, is a unique and exceptional funeral complex of the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ. The quality of the marble work and is the innovative nature of the monument point to the work of an exceptional architect. In that same period, one of the architects we know of is Dinocrates, who was the author of various projects for Alexander the Great. The deceased must have been a very important person at the time to whom a heroic tribute was manifestly given. Walls were set up in front of the sphinxes and the caryatids, and the chambers were filled in with earth to protect the sepulchral structure itself. This happened at about the time of Perseus, the last king of Macedonia, in the 2nd century before Christ. In the last quarter of the 4th century before Christ, various historically significant events took place in the region of Amphipolis. Several generals of Alexander the Great, made famous in literary tradition, have a direct link to the region, Ifestion, Laomedon, Nerchos. Ships for Alexander's fleet that left Amphipolis sailing to Asia Minor was built using wood and mining resources from the Pangaean Hills. According to Diodorus of Sicily, there were various good places along the Strymon to shelter ships. We also know that Cassander sent Roxana, Alexander's legitimate wife, and his son, Alexander, into exile to Amphipolis before putting them to death in 311 before Christ. Two construction engraving in honor of Ifestion have been found on the monument. Παρέλαβον Ιφεστίωνος, together with this monogram over the engravings and on the rosette in the tomb. And this monogram in the rosette. Hephaestion, the great general and friend of Alexander the Great, died in 324 before Christ. The lion, a symbol of bravery and strength, points to a remarkable person and to a man rather than a woman. Beyond the identity of the tomb's occupant, the real strength of the Kasta tumulus and of Amphipolis is the uniqueness of this universal monument. Thank you very much for your attention.